I was in church today, Easter, and I wasn't really paying much attention. And that went on most of the entire time. And I kept repeating, today is my true birthday. Now I can give everything to everything. Now I see everything has everything. Now I give everything to everything. There is no lack anywhere. There's absolutely no lack. Nothing is lacking. Nothing is lacking at all. There is no lack. I was just kept focusing on that. Wasn't paying attention to service. Wasn't singing. Wasn't into it at all. And then somehow I had this tremendous breakthrough. I remember the priest said, he said, I know that there's some people here who are going to have a tremendous revelation of God today here. I know there are people in this church who are going to have that. You know, and so I wasn't paying any attention really to anything. And I suddenly got it. I said, wow. So but I didn't break stride, and it's just like, wow, okay, now I get it. I get the whole thing. Yes, I've been going through the day, just kind of sitting on that. And I'm fine with it. I'm fine with it. But, you know, it's a big thing. It's really a big thing. I don't know if I can explain it. Theoretically, I can. But first of all, then we actually said hello to the priest after service. And I just, you know, shook his hand. And then I said, Happy Easter. God bless, Happy Easter. He said, Happy Easter to you. And I didn't say anything. I was going to tell him. I said, look, I had this tremendous, total understanding of what it really about, what this whole thing is really about. What was Jesus really about? And I got it. But I didn't say anything. I got this sense like, it's not the time and place. No, just keep your stride. Keep your stride. Don't be overwhelmed by any insight that you have. So when you get a huge breakthrough, just say, good, good, good. This is where I'm at. Okay, good, this is where I'm at. And you just keep stride with the day, whatever's happening. Went on with the rest of the Easter day. And I said, okay, I know I got it. Don't have to shout Eureka, fall down in church, you know, go, oh my gosh, everybody, I suddenly understand what it's all about. People look at you like, what? What are you talking about? So, I was walking past the altar after service, and this lady came up to me. She goes, hey, please take a picture of me and my husband, please. So she gave me the camera. I said, okay. And so they went up and sat on the steps of the altar. And so I took a picture of the altar with, behind the altar, a picture of Jesus. And it's funny, as soon as I took the picture, I realized, oh, what the Holy Spirit's telling me, says, you got the picture now. You got the picture. It says, he wants me to take the picture because it knows I got the picture. I did get the picture. The Holy Spirit showed me, you know, what Jesus, really his mission was all about. I said, oh, that's really cool. It's very cool. And I understood the Jewish tradition of the Paschal Lamb, actually, which I've never understood. I never understood any of this, because it's like nobody is explaining it in the right way, really. And now I get it. It's like, wow, okay. And I understood the Eucharist, what it's really supposed to mean, actually. It's really supposed to mean. The whole thing is there. The whole thing is there. It's just not being presented clearly, really. It's all there. It's all there. So I'm just letting it percolate here and seeing maybe I can share this on this video, possible. See if I have the nerve to do that. And maybe even do it backwards. Start backwards. Resurrection. What's God really showing us there? What's the purpose? To show us that, well, I may have to start the other way around, actually. The Paschal Lamb sacrifice for the Jews, they're supposed to get the blemish-free, their very finest lamb, blemish-free, and it's got to be inspected. It's the very best one, okay? Why is this tradition there? Why is this tradition there? You see, and then Jesus is supposed to be the perfect Paschal Lamb for humans here. That's the ultimate reconciliation with God. Okay, how is this possible? Clue has something to do with time and space, as does the Eucharist. The Eucharist is unleavened bread. Passover is the feast where we have unleavened bread. What is unleavened bread? No bubbles in it. No puffed up yeast doesn't puff up and bubble and, you know, huff up. It stays flat. It's flat bread. No yeast. Unleavened. Unleavened bread stands for reality. Pure spaciousness. Solid block. No gaps in it. What does leavened bread stand for? It stands for projection. It stands for space and time. Space and time and fragmentation and appearances in space and time. That's what it stands for. So, when people take the Eucharist, they're reminding themselves that reality is unleavened by imagination. It's unleavened by imagination. Yeast is like the imagination, projection, imagination of spirit that projects as time, space, and appearances in time and space. Unleavened bread is drop the imagination and the one seamless being, the one relationship. The one relationship. Everything is one. Okay. That's the unleavened bread. That's the wafer. That's the Eucharist. But we're afraid to drop time and space. We're afraid to drop time and space because we think that somehow God created time and space and wants us to make perfect time and space, make perfect form, perfect bodies within time and space and become very spiritual in time and space. That's all actually a projection, our imagination. Spirit is the one that is trying to reverse the direction of creation. The sin that we have, original sin, we're trying to make imagination real and reality imagination. That is what we're trying to do. We're trying to reverse the direction of creation, turn it upside down so that we're prime creators. We're creating with imagination and we want that to be real. We want that to be real. But it's not. It'll never be real. So we believe that trying to perfect form in time and space so that the form takes on what we think is the perfect form is the goal, our goal, and then we think God supports that goal. God supports that goal. Now the Paschal Lamb sacrifice for the Jews was supposed to remind the Jews that God does not support time and space and that we have to go towards detachment and change our goal. Why? Because they're giving up the very best lamb that they have, the spotless, blemish-free lamb, the one that's DNA and genes are the best, right? God says, practice detachment from this whole delusion of trying to perfect time, imagination in time and space. Give up your most valuable animal, you know. Drop the whole DNA obsession. Drop the whole genetical obsession. Drop the whole obsession with form. And he says, that pleases me. And you need to remind yourself of that. So it's a very powerful, something very powerful, actually. Now, they say that Jesus is the Lamb of God. Okay. Now, the Paschal Lamb. Now, Jesus was a flawless human, so to speak. The most perfect human. Human, if you think Jesus took a body and was here in the flesh. You know, the highest perfect DNA, the highest genetics, the highest wisdom, everything. Jesus represents the perfect human. The perfect human in time and space. In time and space. But what did Jesus come here for? Jesus came here to show us through the crucifixion that God cares not the slightest bit about time and space and form and appearances in time and space and our attempt to perfect it, etc. Even to the extent of a supposedly a perfect human being totally makes no difference whatsoever. So God accepted the sacrifice of the supposed perfect human being to show us that this whole obsession with flesh, with persons, with people, with bodies, with form, with time, with space, and space is totally illusory, total illusion, total delusion, and we have to give it up. We have to give it up. And so here we have this, we say, God, we got this perfect human being here. And God says, doesn't matter. Give it up. You got to give it up. You got to give it up. Even if you got Jesus, you got to give Jesus up. And so God allowed the sacrifice of the body of Jesus, the form, to take place, to show us that we got to give time and space and form up, no matter how perfect we think it is. God means nothing to God. Nothing. Nothing at all. And God accepts us giving it up. It's not like, say, it's like we say, oh my gosh, we have the perfect human here. Surely God doesn't want us to give that up. We're thinking, surely. And God says, no, you got to give that up. Illusions can never be real. Imagination can never be real. Time and space is unreal. It is a projection. And everything in time, space, the flesh is imagination. So even what we think is a perfect imagination, it's still imagination. You have to give it up. You have to give it up. And God won't say, oh, you know what? You produce such a perfect human being. You got to keep it. You got to keep it. No. So the sacrifice of Jesus showed that God will not say that. And we're truly free to give it up. It doesn't matter what we have or what we come up with in imagination. God will say, set it down for reality. You don't have to hold on to anything. You don't have to hold on to anything. Now, the second aspect is the resurrection. And what God was saying, showing there, was reassuring us that when we set down even a perfect form that we think, quote unquote, perfect, a perfect imaginary form, we set everything down, even the very prime best, we don't fall into some abyss. God is not angry or anything like that. Life is there for you. True life, eternal life, the life of spirit is there. The life of flesh and life of form is nothing. The life of spirit is everything. Everything. So, in seeing this, I saw it all in a flash, and I just got it. I said, wow. I got it. So Jesus was saving his time, saying, look, even if you go on for a trillion years trying to develop the perfect, you know, hybrid, you know, DNA spliced, you know, form and time and space and everything, it's nothing. It's still zero. It's a total zero. It's a total zero. It's a complete waste of time. But God won't tell you have to keep it. God will say, set that down too. Set that down too. God will say, look, if I said set down Jesus, the body of Jesus, set down every body. Set down all bodies, all form, all time, all space. And when you do that, you will find behind your imagination is the reality, the eternal life of reality, the unleavened eternal life of reality, unleavened by imagination. So when I saw it, I said, wow, thank you, Jesus. That's really, really cool. You really did do something. Very, very great. That is awesome. Very nice. Wow. Jesus was just showing us, hey, stop worshiping form. Stop worshiping form, time, space. You think you've got the ultimate in time and space and form? I'll show you the ultimate in time, space, and form. Stop even worshiping that. It's nothing. It'll never satisfy you. This was a very heavy lesson. And people were very bewildered, weren't they? Says, what's going on? You know, here we have this like perfect being, and suddenly they're hanging on a cross, crucified. You know, and then they'll resurrect. What? You know, what is going on here? And now, finally, 2,000 years later, 2,000 plus, well, actually less than 2,000, because it was, what, 33 A.D. in the crucifixion. Maybe about, what, 19? 1,981 years later, the light goes on, you know, in a church. I said, oh my gosh, that is what you were doing. Very, very cool, very interesting, very helpful. Jesus is saying, look, form is nothing to God. Nothing. Nothing at all. God created spirit and truth, didn't create form, didn't create imagination, projection, did not create time and space. Time and space, projection, form, all of that is an imagination. Spirit wanting to be prime creator and imagining it's possible. Trying to perfect form, you see. So we took the most perfect form possible, and then Jesus said, look, it's still nothing. It's still nothing. Jesus said, you think this form's great? The form of Jesus is great? I want to show you. To God, it is nothing. God is nothing. You want to attack it and scourge it and crucify it and everything. It's still nothing. It doesn't matter. God's not in the... See, they thought that God would rescue. Remember the thief on the cross said, why don't you call your God to rescue you? if you're a son of God, come on. Be rescued. He said, no, because form is nothing to God. Really, it is nothing. And this is the shock. The shock is still going throughout the world, and most people have not been able to process the shock. Process the shock of it. And it's like the Eucharist, you know, the purpose of it. Again, they haven't been able to process that. They're saying time, space, everything that arises in time and space is nothing but an illusion. It's a mirage. It's a useless mirage designed to convince our imagination that it's possible to be real. You know, it's possible to be real. It's not. And God's saying, be confirmed to the one relationship of true being that everything shares. All shares with all. In the pure spaciousness, the pure everywhereness that is God. The unleavened reality, unleavened by imagination. Drop the imagination. You have to. Even your imagination of Jesus, even this imagination that here is God here in the flesh, in this world, and look what took place, you see. So it's a huge shocker. And people, I don't think they've got it yet. They don't have it yet. And when it dawned on me, it was just like, oh yeah, okay. But it has taken a lifetime of effort to get to this point. Now, I was reading Journey Beyond Words by Dr. Brent Haskell. I actually picked up a copy recently, a couple days ago. And I was reading about it, and Jesus is so emphatic. And that's a very helpful book. And he's so emphatic about space-time, you know, it's telling you it's just a projection, it's your imagination, it's nothing. It's the big problem, it's the delusion, and just over and over, it's the oneness is where it's at. And maybe some, that like a big boost I got from that, and then I just saw it sitting in church, standing. So that's what it was about. That's what it was about. Thank you, Holy Spirit, you know, for showing that. And that's what the whole sacrificial tradition is all. Prize lamb, the prize genetic strain. It's all about reminding ourselves the genetics is nothing. The DNA is nothing. The time and space is nothing. It has absolutely nothing to do with reality whatsoever. It's an attempt to actually turn reality upside down. That's what it really is. And so here we have like Jesus, which is the ultimate perfect DNA, right? Perfect DNA. And people are saying, here is the model, here is the savior, here is the bloodline that will save, turn the world into paradise. And what does God do? Says, no, I'm not the slightest bit interested in that body at all. Not at all. It's a zero, just like everything else is a zero. Crucified with common thieves, riffraff, criminals, murderers, you know, on a cross. In other words, God saying, this is all zero. It's all zero to me. So even this perfect DNA of Jesus was zero to God. And Jesus, of course, knew all about this. And he is showing us that God, the body is nothing. DNA is nothing. That's why Christians are trying to pull away from the entire DNA blood strain aristocracy thing of existence. Which is why the Romans persecuted him so badly. Yeah. They say, they're worshiping this dead DNA. You know, they had perfect DNA and they killed it and they're worshiping the death of Jesus. You know, they're crazy, that kind of thing. So, because to the aristocracy, bloodlines, genetics, DNA are so important. And by the way, to the fourth dimensionals, it's super, super important. And they have a whole hybrid program they work on hybridizing extraterrestrials and humans, working with DNA, and they plan to have these people establish, you know, royal bloodlines on this planet and all this kind of stuff. When Jesus completely frees us from that, if we understand what the whole thing was about. So I just feel like, wow. I'm still feeling it. That's really cool. That's really practical. You know, that's great, actually. I have a new appreciation for Jesus, for sure. And for the Eucharist. But it's not clarified. If people really are getting it, that's news to me. It's news to me. But there's something inside of them, I think, Christians, something inside of them that there's something responding at some level. You know, it just hasn't really burst through in the purity and the clarity of the entire situation. But there's something they say, you know what? Body's really not that important. If Jesus' body wasn't important to God, then my body sure isn't important to God. You know, it's kind of like that. So, overall, I'd say it's a positive thing. It's a positive thing. Christianity is a positive situation overall. You know, from my perspective, I'm looking at it now. Anything that turns attention away from bloodlines, genetics, DNA, body, importance of the body, anything that does that is very helpful, actually. We don't have to martyrdom. We don't have to do that. We don't have to dress down. We don't have to try and scourge the body or anything like that. Now, all we have to do is get it. Is accept this truth. The light within us was responding to it. It was the light within me that sort of burst forth and showed this to me. Because I was ready to accept it. But I was dressed nicely, you know, slacks and a dress shirt, and you know, I was very, very presentable. I usually am very presentable in public, as are everyone, you know, in this area. But that doesn't stop anyone from getting it, you know, from understanding this. And what it does is it enables true detachment to blossom, true detachment to blossom within us. And I feel very much in that way. Maybe when true detachment is blossoming, I may even dress up more, you know, dress up a little fancier, just as to kind of try to maintain an appearance in the world. When true detachment is like you're saying, wow, I have not the slightest interest in bodies or form or winners or losers or anything whatsoever like that. And that's how I'm feeling that way. But you still have to keep up appearances. When in Rome, do as Romans do, right? Rent under Caesar's what is Caesar's. So we don't have to appear real spiritual looking. You know, we don't have to appear that way. That's not the point of the situation. So that was my Easter. That was real amazing. It, you know, someone actually had a breakthrough in the church. How about that? A real breakthrough. It's amazing. The priest said this, that some of you here are going to have a breakthrough today. He's never said that before. He just said that. He said some of you have a breakthrough. This is a really good priest. This priest is somehow in touch with some light. Some aspect of him is in touch with some light. He comes through now and then. You can kind of see it. He's sort of like an intuitive priest. That he's got some aspect beyond the form of the religion, actually. Beyond the form of the religion. He's not, you know, cookie cutter sort of thing. Some of you are going to have a breakthrough. Yeah, the breakthrough, I'm still feeling it. I'm still feeling it. It's been, since 7, 11, 8 hours. And this is a super heavy insight. I can see why it doesn't come very often. You have to just be able to keep your stride. And you know, say, okay, that's great. And got a lot of other insights to come too. So let's not fixate on this. Let's not grasp a hold of it. Insights often come when you see a lot of territory. You go, oh, wow, I can really make a lot of progress. You see insight, say, okay, that's good. I need to keep moving here. And there's another one here and another one here. And you kind of keep moving. You should not get fixated on any insight. Ultimately, the detachment and the vision of oneness is the goal. Vision of oneness is the goal. No teacher in themselves, no form is the goal at all. So don't worship teachers, don't worship any form at all. Get some advice, get some help, inspiration, motivation, all that kind of stuff, sure. But the goal is this vision of oneness. It is this true detachment. It's a true meditation, it's a true contemplation. Where what is happening in time and space doesn't matter at all. You realize it has no bearing on what you are, no bearing on your home, no bearing on your reality, no bearing on anything about you whatsoever, really. None. Zero. That even if you're sort of a perfect human person, it still has no bearing. Zero. It's zero for everybody. If it's zero for Jesus, it's zero for everybody. You see, it's the great zeroing out. Crucifixion, the great zeroing out. Zero for everybody. It took that all off our backs. Took it all, that lifted the burden off of all of us. Jesus says, look, it's all zero in time and space. It's nothing. Give it up. Exchange it for the vision of oneness. It'll always be just nothing. And accept this on the deep level of light with the light within you. Not on an intellectual level. Don't try to pose, be a poser. Don't try to be a poser. Just let the light within you accept this and soak it in and vibrate with it. Everything's a zero, and then go beyond the zero. And the resurrection showed us beyond the zero of time and space is the eternal life, is the true life. Not subject to death or decay, crucifixion, anything like that. So we can we can detach, we can accept the zero of time and space, we can go totally off script, we can have everything go off script right now. Everything go off script right now. The totality of time and space all go off script right now. To zero. All go off script to zero and simply abide in that zero. So the Eucharist is really saying your goal is to give up time and space. Your goal is to give up time and space. Remember that Jesus did not value his body at all. Did not value his body at all. Placed no value upon it. To show you God places no value on bodies. God places no value on form. God places no value on time and space whatsoever. No value. So this is a jumbo insight, jumbo experience, quite an experience, really. Didn't see it coming, really. No, I didn't see it coming. And then that the lady insisting I take the picture, and then realizing I got the picture, you know, I'm able to get this picture of what it's really about. Okay, that's fine. And again, keep stride with other breakthroughs to come. Other breakthroughs to come. So, looking forward to that. Looking forward to detachment, true detachment. The great ones of detachment. Who are the great ones of detachment? We had a couple of them. A couple of ones, models. Ramana Maharshi was one of them, for sure. Anandamaya Mahavishnu was another one, for sure. Those two ideal models of detachment. And of course, Jesus was so utterly, completely detached and realized there's zero value in the body. He said, I'm going to show you, I'm going to set my body down, I'm going to allow it to be crucified. I see no value in it, but there's no value in it whatsoever. But we are not called to do that. The one example was enough, but we are called to be models of detachment, true spiritual attachment. Not just I'm living in a hut by a lake somewhere, you know, that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about being willing to have everything go off script. The lake off script, the hut off script, the forest off script, the simple bed off script, your little loaf of bread off script, the atoms off script, the air off script, the beautiful mountains off script, the earth off script, the universe off script. We're talking about time, space, and appearances in time and space off script entirely. In the modern world, it's necessary to keep up appearances, keep your job, you know, keep everything going. So most people are in a situation where they need to practice detachment right in their life, right where they are, right here, right now. So a good model right now is someone who's just, doing the same. Not somebody with a long hair and beard in a hut somewhere. Because who can do that right now? Realistically, it's becoming super prohibitively difficult, actually. But rather somebody who looks like they can keep a job, keep a career, keep a family going, keep payments on the house, on the car, on retirement, you know, everything that, all the demands on their life, somebody who looks like that, you know, oh yeah, they could do that, sure. And at the same time be totally detached, totally detached. It's because we need to practice detachment right where we are. Have a little space in your house where you practice detachment every day. And then in the morning, go to work. Morning, go to work. Keep earning money. Absolutely. Yeah, we can't all go to India and drop out, and I wouldn't recommend that for anybody, actually. Very, very few fit into that, actually. Very few. We've been through that all since the 50s, actually. It started earlier than that, in the 40s, and a few people, you know, dropouts, go to, you know, India, but we've all been through the whole thing. That's not where it's at. Very few do that, and they may have a really rough time, but actually, it's not where it's at. Right where you are, practice detachment right where you are. From all time and space, give permission for all time and space and everything to go off script right now. Totally off script. As if nothing is happening. The whole idea of winners and losers, stop, full stop to that, because everything's off script. And so it ruins the entire future script, doesn't it? The future script is like not there anymore, because how can you determine the winners and losers? If everything goes off script, everything went off script. So full stop. That's what's real detachment. Now, the Holy Spirit seems to be moving me in a certain direction right now. There's a pattern of stuff happening right now, and I say, okay. Yeah, so there are some folks who will think that a detachment has to happen. So someone sitting on an antelope skin or a tiger skin in a cave, in the Himalayas, with the long beard and the long hair and the mala, you know, the beads, the little accoutrements or whatever they have, it can only happen there. That's not true. It's not true at all. There's nothing to indicate Jesus was some, you know, total hippie dropout. Actually, he was welcomed into prominent families and had great, you know, all these relatives and friends, and you know, he was highly, highly esteemed, you know, throughout the community in certain circles. So there's nothing to indicate that he was just some wild man dropout, as it were. No. We have to practice in our homes, where we are, our apartments, our homes, our dwelling places, every day, just as we are. And what's more, as we move towards more and more affluence in the world, as we move towards the fourth dimensional, quote-unquote, golden age, it's even more important to have models that are dwelling in such a situation, a very nice situation, actually. And they're practicing detachment there, and they're saying, this is nothing. It's all nothing. It's all equally nothing. Because that's where people are going to be at, is, you know, in this world, if this world is able to continue on, which we hope it does, you know. They are going to need to practice detachment within the quote-unquote material affluence where they're going to be at. Because it doesn't matter if they want to hang out in the jungles of Costa Rica or something like that. They'll have their smartphone there, right? They'll have all their apps there. Everybody's tuned in, plugged in. There's no, you know, nobody's going to be that detached at all in the future. So why don't we stop playing games? You know, this is where we're at now. And right where we're at, we need to practice detachment. And then just get after it. Get after it. So, it seems the Holy Spirit is moving me. Definitely not towards the hippiness, the whole hippie, wild man, crazy wisdom thing. Definitely not in that direction. No, that's the wrong way. It's moving me towards a situation of a very conservative, affluent, just, you know, steady, kind of nice place, scenario type of thing. Where people, you know, have valuing in the beauty of their surroundings and like that. But right within that beautiful surroundings, which, you know, so many people are trending in that direction, trying to trend in that direction. And the idea of this fourth dimensional is taking over, is they're going to, you know, get everybody in a nice situation. So within that situation, everyone has to practice detachment on a daily basis, just like an exercise program. So you have that beautiful, beautiful this and beautiful that, and the swimming pools, and all the, you know, all the free energy or solar energy, whatever you've got. You think, wow, I just got so much stuff, so nice, and landscapes, beautiful landscaping, and then you say, you know what, I really have to detach from all of this time, space, and everything, and no matter how nice it may seem. It's nothing. But at the same time, again, your life has to continue here. So most people have tremendous responsibilities here. So people need examples along this genre of detachment, that is for sure. So. So I seem to be going in that direction. I seem to be, you know, going trending in that direction. We'll see. We'll see. It's really not for me, the whole hippie, dropout, guru, India, all that kind of stuff. No, that's spiritual romanticism, really. And a lot of the non-dual teachers are just regular people, you know, just dressed very, very clean cut, very nice, everything is, you know, that way, because that's where people are at, and they got to practice attachment where they're at, have to, no choice. If they have a lot of leisure, people have a lot of leisure, out playing golf, whatever, they have to practice that also too. They have to practice attachment there too, in all their activities of life. As they're wearing their nice clothes, driving their nice car, they have to practice detachment too. What's that? Oh, I have a great car. Well, still have to give up everything in time space, all time and space, everything off script right now. My nice car off script, my nice clothes off script, my nice house off script. My nice spouse off script, my nice family off script, my nice pets off script, my nice investments off script, my nice future off script, my nice job off script, career off script, colleagues off script, friends off script, everything off script right now. This is where it's really at. This is where it's really at. This practicing detachment is where it's really at. And I'm feeling it now. I'm feeling it. I'm going in that direction, trending in that direction. You know, you can be a CEO and practice detachment. You can have your own private jet off script entirely. Everything equally off script. Just feel that. Just allow it. Allow yourself to feel it. Jesus has already zeroed everything out here. All form zeroed out. He's shown absolutely that God does not value form at all. So you can take that to the bank. It's a great thing, Jesus, to take it to the bank. That God values not form at all. So you don't have to either. You can allow everything to go off script. You will not be punished for that. You will not, God will not be angry and say, what are you doing? I've given you all this nice form and time and space. What are you doing? You're crazy. No, absolutely not. God places no value upon time, space, and form whatsoever. None. Zero value. So we can allow everything to go off script too and not feel that we're going to get in trouble with God. Jesus gave us that assurance. Saved us from our sin. Of projection, time and space and form, right? Location and time and space. Location implies time and space, actually. Because one location, you need two locations to make location seem, you know. And in time and space, it's no value to time and space and things, fragments, location, no value. No value, no value. So we can place no value on it also. Be assured that God also doesn't place value on this form, location, and time and space either. If God didn't value Jesus, he doesn't value us in terms of time, space, and form. Not at all. Zero. So let it all go off script. Let it all go off script. No matter how nice your car is, where I live, everybody's got the nicest car. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. Ah, oh, man. It's, a lot of money in California now. That is for sure. And they all got their new cars. They all got their new cars. People are, you know, of course they value them, but you have to let everything go off script. New car, old car, junk car, no car, sun, the moon, the stars, no sun. Space, no space, time, no time, whatever, just the whole conceptual imaginary realm. Let just everything go off script simultaneously. Give permission for everything to go off script. And then the whole thing of winners and losers and trying to sift through it all to find who the real winner is in time and space and imagination. That's all out the window now, right? You might as well start over, because the whole script now, it all went off script. And how can we now be sure that there's a really, this winner is really the winner and this loser is really the loser? Okay, the cat, stop. It throws a monkey wrench into it, doesn't it? It really throws a monkey wrench into the total thing, which is good. So throw a monkey wrench into it. Imagine everything, imagine imagination being going off script. Just imagine it. Allow yourself to imagine that. Everything off script. Full stop there. Full detachment right there. Right there. So actually, Christianity helps us with that. Jesus helps with that by showing God doesn't even value, you know, God doesn't value any form, including yours, including everything, every form in time and space. No value. So let it go off script. Let it go off script. Okay. All right. Very great. Wrap up this video and just keep the stride going. Okay, very great. That's it.